Today, we don't have to use our brains. We've done that all week. We don't have to use it today. There's going to be no quantum physics, no, particles interacting with each other. It's just going to be what they call simple life, which isn't very simple. But the reason I'm here, one of the reasons I'm here is that Jim and I, 18 years ago, moved to the woods, and we've been there ever since. And then Jim and I got together. We had gone off, we had worked for a year. I had a part-time job, Jim had a full-time job. We managed to live on my part-time salary. We quit. And we went to Europe. We spent, I think, a total of 9 months that time because Jim was going to school in Rome. We were in a campground in Rome for 6 months during the winter months, I might add. And then when we came back to the United States, we found we were expecting our first child. And we lived with some friends for a couple of months. And during that time, you naturally watched TV every night, and you did the normal stuff. So when we moved into our own little apartment, we said, well, we need a TV. That's essential because, what do you do? You have to have a TV. But when I look back at that moment of thinking about the TV, I realized that was one of the crucial moments in what eventually led us into the adventure of going off into the woods, because we went to the store and there were 50 screens all showing the same program, and we were supposed to choose which one we wanted to, and we stopped and we said, now look, we can come back to the store any day of the week and buy our TV. What would happen if we didn't do it? Well, we didn't know what would happen if we didn't do it, but we thought, well, let's give it a try, because, like I said, we can always change our minds. So we went back to our little apartment, and one of the first things we did was we went to the neighborhood library. And so we would get a pile of books and take them home and start reading. The first 2 weeks were very, very hard, because we had to, in a sense, take control of our own time. And we had to learn. We were children trying to figure out, what to do with ourselves. So, after those initial 2 weeks were over, the reading, the going to the library, the getting books, and I can't tell you how many discussions Jim and I had about everything. Now, those discussions became the new foundation of what we were supposed to do with our life. Because a child was on the way, Jim had to get another job because, again, we had quit and we had to go find a job. We had a mortgage. If we wanted to buy a house, we'd have a 20 or 30 year mortgage. I guess back then it was only a 20 year mortgage. And then the kids would go to school and we'd be locked in until we were 65, and then we'd be set free and then we could do what we wanted to do. Okay, so that was the first important thing that we did. The second important thing that we did was Jim would buy a lottery ticket. He would spend his dollar and bring the lottery ticket home, and he would put it on the table and he would say, now what would we do if we won the lottery? Now I know this sounds bizarre, but it's an excellent tool to try to get your mind thinking in a new way. So we ended up with a grand total of four things that we would do. One would be a trip around the world. Two would be house and land. Three would be a union analyst, because we had a really, at that point, a really deep interest in psychology, and Jim thought about going back to Switzerland and becoming a union analyst. And the fourth one was to take a really long retreat. So with that list in mind, we started thinking about what our next move would be. I'm not going to tell you a lot, because in the afternoon I'm going to show you a little video, and that'll give you a little more idea of what our journey was to the woods, but one thing we did do was I was expecting our second child 3 weeks before John was born. Guess what? Jim quit his job. 3 weeks before he was born, he quit his job. And 3 weeks afterwards, we took off to the mountains. We were living in San Diego at the time. We took off into the mountains in the Sierra Nevada. And we started a retreat because we didn't know what we really wanted to do and we needed the time to think it out. Okay. One thing that I want you to do is think about what would happen if you bought a lottery ticket and you had it in front of you. I'd like you people to imagine that you have a lottery ticket and you have a really good chance, 1 in 250,000 million people, you're going to win the lottery. Okay? But there it is. You spent your dollar bill. How are you going to make your list? Jim and I made ours because that suited our personalities. But what would your list be?
Of course, we were blessed at our table with sisters, and they want to give everything away. But there were a few of us that would like to spend our money. But I did feel like that the majority of the funds, I'm sure, would go for other people's benefits. But we thought about traveling and security in our later years to have an income that would be there for us. And one individual felt like maybe giving money to relatives wouldn't, at least don't give them too much because they need to struggle. That's okay.
Many of it was to help relatives and friends in their financial difficulty, use it to establish programs or foundations that would empower others and help alleviate some of the problems of the world. But also, we all kept a little bit, perhaps, for our own development, and not just necessarily in a material way, but also for spiritual growth, the enjoyment of leisure, which I personally believe is so important if we are to learn to pray and to love, that we have the leisure to do that. So maybe hopefully we hit a little bit of a happy medium. We didn't snub the gift horse, but we did use it for good things, for ourselves, for those closest to us, and then out to the world and for the needy.
Father Tom was talking to us about this, and he said that he had already done a couple of things that were important to him. If he had had a list, the two things that were most important to him were ecumenism and then the John Main way of praying. And he felt that he was really blessed because he got to take the two things and create unitas. And so to him that was really important. But there was another aspect to that that was really significant, because I said, well, if you were to make a list now, what would you put on your list? And he said, play the harmonica. Now, I think this is significant because a lot of times we're thinking in big, wide strokes, you know, about how we're going to change the world and we're going to do good, you know, take away poverty and all that. But what about us? What about some things that actually don't require money, at least not a lot if you're going to buy a harmonica, that we should be doing? And it's sort of like when I named the four things that we had desired. Those were big things. But we also have other things like, oh gee, I'd really like to paint a picture, or I'd like to do calligraphy, or, you know, take up an instrument, or whatever. What about that? are some things that you guys would like to put on this kind of secondary list? It's a way of, the theme is simple living, right? But it starts with ourselves. And so if we ignore some of those, what we consider little things, that are really not valuable in the world. I remember we were at a retreat and there was a couple. And she said, well, you know, I'd really like to learn how to play the flute, but you know, that's not important. And, you know, I really have to take care of the kids, and, you know, go to work and take care of my husband. And so if I learn how to play the flute, that's like selfish time. It's taking time away from the things that are important and my duty and all that. And so she was denying herself. And I think a lot of times we are denying ourselves those really what we might consider peculiar things. But those things have to do with parts of ourselves that are, it's almost like nagging at us. Oh, you know, I'd really like to write a poem, or I'd like to read a book by so-and-so, just have the time by myself, but I can't afford to do it. You know, that's really not important, and I won't do it. So what I'd like you guys to do is to go back into your circle, forget the money, because we're not talking dollars now. What we're talking about is an inner wealth. How do we tap into our inner treasure trove? What's down there that's making you feel on another level sort of poverty stricken? And what can you do? Little things that all these years you've been saying no, 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 but that you really owe to yourself to do.
I'll tell you, the gamut of our desires was so great that we almost all do need to come up. We have everything from just being aware of our interpersonal relationships and healing those with other people, to taking all kind of personal enrichment courses in music or language, computer, and we had those who worried about worrying, you know, that more trust was needed, and those who were interested in yoga and meditation, and if I forget anything, just holler it out. It's important because I think every single person was so varied and different that we just thought we had a great group over here. We did. We also mentioned that whenever we do something that we really want to do, we're filled with an unbounding energy that comes from where we don't know. No matter how much we've been working or how tired we are, the energy seems to be there when we're doing something that we really desire. And that's what makes it so important.
I really can't add too much beyond what you have said. You know, we had pretty much the same desires. Paint, some of us wanted to paint. Travel, more control of their time. But now here's a sour note, and everybody can take it the way they want to. But all of this costs money. You can't get into painting and books and tapes and retreats and all of this without that money. I'm finding that out, being on retirement and Social Security, all these things I wanted to do. It takes money.
We talk more about time than money. You know, if we just had the time to do all these great, wonderful things. And so we went through the sort of thing that I think the rest of you did, coming up with these wonderful things to do. And but then we sort of moved on beyond that. And our discussion was, I thought, tremendous, and it was more like, for our very own selves, what do we need to enrich us, to make our lives full in a way that they haven't been full before. And there was a lot of talk about art and that sort of thing, and being able to, I'm forgetting what I was going to say, it was one point over here that was so good. Some of us are already beginning to work part-time instead of full-time. And so it's using that extra time wisely, and not just using it to putter around the house or do more of what you do on the weekends anyway, but to really make use of that extra time and to start small, you know, so that you don't fail. Do at least one thing this year, maybe one thing, or, you know, this month and something else the next month, and really accomplish something, like learning to play an instrument and that sort of thing. But do I have permission to call you? Okay. One of our members has been, if I've had the story straight, so touched very during this session that she has decided to quit her job and to move and to go into massage therapy.
That initial list that Jim and I made, we eventually, in one form or another, did something on each one of those matters, though more often than not, it was not the way we had envisioned it in the very beginning. Another thing, too, is you talk about time and money. The one thing that was very important to us, because of our propensity to have, one, the spiritual foundation, and two, to have the propensity to have a job and quit in order to have the time. We wanted the time. So what we did was we made a deal with fate, and you're going to see a video this afternoon about what happened. Now, this is not necessarily a success story. We have been there 18 years, and that speaks for itself. We actually survived. We didn't die. But we made a lot of mistakes, and they may not be evident, and then again, they may in the video, but we made a lot of mistakes, and we learned to pick ourselves up and try it another way, and if that failed, then try it another way, and, you know, just know it's good, because if you want to paint, or if you want to travel, or whatever, you just might not be able to do it the way you envision it, this kind of glowing dream, and you have to make allowances, because we're still not quite perfect, and life out there isn't perfect, so you have to make compromises. I was really pleased with how it went this morning. I noticed kind of an emotional difference between the first go-around with what you would do with your lottery ticket and then the second go-around with what would happen as far as your personal list. And you guys really came alive with that. That was good. You know, that, I think that's really valuable, because if you're going to have a simple life, it has to start with you, me, everyone, one by one, individually. I'm going to be showing the video in a couple of minutes, but I just thought I'd give you some background on one part of the story. The day after our first child was born, Jim started a job working for the county of San Diego. And one of the major concerns we had was house and land. So because we're such rational, reasonable human beings, the first thing Jim wanted to do was to discover a tropical island so that he could run off and live the tropical island fantasy, where he would pull off the coconuts from the trees and, you know, the fish would kind of jump up into his hands and, you know, that would be our life. So he plotted to take off, and so he accrued all his vacation days. He didn't take any extra days. He heaped together, I think it was 2 weeks, and then there was a few days of sick leave. That's what it was. So he managed to get 3 days altogether, 3 weeks altogether. So off to the library again, big pile of books, and we searched through every known island, especially in the Caribbean, because we're sort of interested in that. So we made charts, and we put down the names, and we classified them according to, well, what's the population, what's the weather, and, you know, all this other stuff. And what's the terrain like? Does it have mountains? And, you know, who does it belong to? And so here we go, chart, chart, chart. And then he started working in March, and the following May, he decided that there was one island that really interested him, and it was called the Bay Islands, which is 40 miles off the coast of Honduras. One of the beauties of this island is that nobody's ever heard of the Bay Islands. So if nobody's heard of it, then there aren't going to be a lot of tourists there. The prices aren't going to be high. You can live on the beach, and, you know. So by that time, I was pregnant with the second child. And naturally, because I was pregnant, I couldn't go, right? So to go to this island, one of the requirements is to take anti-malarial pills, because you don't want to get malaria when you're down there. So 2 weeks before departure day, he gets the pills and he starts taking them, and I'm watching him do this. Elizabeth is, a year and 2 months. I'm watching this and I'm saying to myself, he's going to go to a tropical island fantasy without me. I don't like this very much. Also, there was the possibility, knowing Jim, that he would go, and he would decide he didn't like it, and he'd never return. I never would be able to get to go on my own. He wouldn't want to go back, and so I said, you know, I want to go too. And that means that Elizabeth has to go. So off we go to the doctor, we get more anti-malarial pills. There I am, mashing them up in the bananas so that Elizabeth can eat them. Okay, so off we go. We fly to Guatemala City, and then we have to go over to San Pedro Sula in Honduras and down to La Ceiba, and they have these teeny little planes called DC-3s that are just, they're just put together by masking tape and aluminum foil, because when it takes off, it rattles. The whole thing rattles. You know, you figure you're going to end up in the ocean. And so when you finally get to the island, this is not a runway we're talking about. This is a coral beach. This is crushed coral. So we land, and the main street is not paved, and the houses are in stilts, and the water is under them. And the pigs are rooting around the main street, up and down the street. And people are doing their laundry under the little verandas, you know, by hand, of course, and little gardens. And it's also primarily Black Island, and everybody speaking English. One of the things about this island is, though, even though it belonged to Honduras, they spoke English, and they were above speaking Spanish. So they really didn't like the Hondurans very much when they came over. The first night we stayed in the best room of the only hotel on the street. And all it meant was it was a little bigger than everything else. And there were no screens on the window. We put the light on, and my gosh, the menagerie that came in, you know, to greet us in the night. We turned that off right away. And we're wondering what's going to happen to us. But we ended up going to the other side of the island, and it was really beautiful beach. And just down the way was a reef with a tropical fish like you wouldn't believe. We would get to know the natives. We'd walk up and down the beach, but there was one problem. Around 10 o'clock in the morning, it got so hot and muggy, we could barely move. And so we just found our way back to the cinder block room, opened our novels, and tried to survive until it started getting cool again. We found the natives all came out around 10 o'clock at night, and everybody was walking around with a Coke bottle, and they're all trying to survive. The food was really expensive because it had to be shipped in from the mainland, and there wasn't much opportunity for work, and so usually the breadwinner of the family was off with the merchant marines, and he was sending money home to the wife and a whole slew of kids. So we decided after 1 week of that that we really couldn't stand that. So somebody told us about the land of the eternal spring, which was in Guatemala. We flew back to Guatemala City and went up to Lake Atitlan in a little town called the Panajachel. Now up there you have the Indians. They're all about 4 feet, well, whatever, 5 feet tall. These are the tallest ones. And each town has its own costume. In other words, if you're from Panajachel, you wear certain stripes, and if you're from Solana, you wear some other kind. So at a glance, you can tell where the people are from, which was really unusual for me. We went to the marketplace, and for $1, we got this giant bag of food. A head of lettuce was 3 cents. Tomatoes they practically gave to you. It was $1 because we spent a whole quarter on a pineapple. You know, it was just so that economically it was a dream. But we also realized that we really didn't want to live in Guatemala, and we didn't want to live outside the U.S. And so we ended up giving up that dream and going back to the States, but not before flying off to Tikal. But it required another plane trip into the dense jungles. All you could see occasionally was smoke coming up in the middle of, you know, this tremendous jungle. And we come down, we get out of the plane, we nearly die. 17. We immediately run under the wing, and then we find ourselves a hotel room, and it rains, and it's made out of cement, and so the first night, everything in our room is getting soaked because they don't have a proper roof. So to compensate for this, they tell us that there's a little jungle hut that's part of the hotel complex that is palm thatched. And so they let us spend the night there, and it's fabulous. You know, this is what the natives are doing. They're the ones that are dry and protected. And we go off to, oh, it's about half a mile away. Here's Elizabeth in her little umbrella stroller. And we're watching the spider monkeys running through the trees. And we come up and see this beautiful multi-stairred temple, Temple of the Sun. And so I don't go up because I'm pregnant and Liz is little. So Jim goes up to the very top. And you know, this was a real experience. But we go back to Guatemala City and fly back to the U.S. And we have to go back to the drawing boards. I'm not going to tell you any more. I mean, I could take each little part of our step of our journey, but they didn't all work. That one didn't work, but we gained a lot just from having gone through the experience. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is dim the lights and we'll see the video. To find the land, first we looked around California, along the central coast, we really liked that. We found that the price per acre was astronomical. And so we went to Oregon, and we went to a real estate agent. He said there were a couple of pieces of land for sale, and we got in touch with the landowners and this and that, but for one reason or another, the deals didn't go through. For instance, one guy said he would sell us 10 acres of land, but he went down to the real estate agent and put an addendum on the deed saying that he had all the rights to the timber, which means he was going to give us a piece of desert, which now was forested but would soon be, you know, cut off. And so he's getting to know us, and he's saying, look, are you guys really serious about this? Because you have the two kids, you must be nuts. But if you really want to do this, I know where there's a piece of land, and they'll sell it to you. It's not even on the market. And so it was a 40-acre piece, and we got the 20 acres that had the hill because we wanted the southern exposure. That's how we got it. As far as the trees on our land, yeah, we can cut them because they're ours.
But they're dying. That's why we're cutting them.
Yeah, there's been a drought for the past bunch of years. And so the firs especially are dying. And so we're cutting them to do the structural stuff.
Is there enough that you feel, I'm sure that it will take care of you folks, but are you planting more so that they can be, or what do you need to? Do they replant themselves? Or?
Well, yeah, they do plant themselves, but our 20 acres is really, has a lot of trees on it. There was a 160-acre parcel, 20 of which, our 20 was part of that. And what happened was some guy came in and logged almost all of it and unfortunately neglected to pay the owners for this. He ran off with the money. But he didn't really do too much damage to our 20 acres because of the hill. Mm-hmm. The rest of it was flat. He could get to it easy, hit and run, you know.
Sure.
And we still have a lot of trees.
How far are you from a hospital, doctor? How long would it take you to get to a hospital or doctor?
Klamath Falls is 40 miles away. And so we have 5 miles of dirt road to get to the main highway. And then we have to go down to Klamath Falls, so it would take us about an hour. But everybody always asked me that, and including one of our friends, we were in Queens. We were driving over to get to Manhattan, and at the time he was asking that, there was a traffic jam on the bridge. Nobody could get across, including an ambulance with the lights going. And so, sure, if something really horrible happened, you probably only have about 5 minutes anyway. You get somebody breathing and, you know, their heart going or whatever. And so we've had a little CPR and we pray a lot. But luckily we haven't had anything go wrong so far. I that, so we really don't have a doctor in town. What we are doing, though, is, because we're concerned with our health, is we take a lot of vitamins, and we are subscribing to an alternative health newsletter that we get every month. So that gives us an idea of stuff that we can do ourselves, because I guess living like this, we want to do for ourselves rather than the professional, if it's feasible. I mean, if I've got a broken leg, sure, I'm going to, you know, get it fixed and stuff. But if it's in the gray area, which a lot is, and I can do something for myself that's more natural, I'd certainly try to do that rather than, you know, cut and drug.
And you do home education for the girls?
Yeah. John and Elizabeth were 3 and a half and 5 when we moved to the woods. And previously to that, when Liz was only 3 and a half, Jim got a book out of the library called How to Teach a Preschooler How to Read. And I said, oh yeah, right. Because at that time we were living in New Hampshire, and I had no idea of doing any of this, and I really wasn't very interested anyway. But the book said, well, you get index cards and you put cat on one and dog on another. You know. So I was doing this with Liz because she was 3 and a half. Well, John was hanging around, he was 2. And so one day, I put the card down on the table, and John said the word. And I said, oh yeah, right, fluke. And so I put down the next word, and he said that one right too. He did 8 words in a row correctly, upside down. Because he was on the other side of the coffee table. So then I said, oh dear, I'm going to have to pay attention to both of them. And so at that point, what I did was I continued these words, I made little sentences, and each day I would take a piece of typing paper, fold it in half, and say, Elizabeth has a doll, John has a truck, that kind of thing. And so then they had their own little pile of books, because I couldn't find anything simple enough or abundant enough. If I found one or two, it really didn't suit. So that's how it started. So by the time we got to the woods, we had had this habit now for, well, a year and a half, and so we just kept it up, because in the wintertime it's just totally unfeasible to go. Now at this point, Liz is 23 and John is 21. They did not go to school until they wanted to go to college, and so I remember, because we used to go down to Baja California for maybe 2 weeks or a month or whatever with the kids. And John was 17, and I said, okay, John, you're 17, what are you going to do with your life? Because you know, you have to get into gear here. And he said, well, you know, I'll go to college someday. And I said, well, I had the SAT book with me, and I said, according to this calendar, there's going to be an SAT exam in April. This is February. Why don't we study this book, and then you can take the SAT, and et cetera. So something clicked in his brain. All of a sudden he went into high gear. We raced back to the States, went back home, and found out that in order to get into the local college, all he had to do was pass his GED. He studied for a week. He took the test, I think it was on Friday night, so we took him in 2 separate weeks. And within the month he was going to college for the spring term. And so he really liked it. Now Liz did the same thing later, because she really was ambivalent. She passed the GED herself, and she started going to college, but she didn't like it. What she liked to do was she liked to paint, and she liked to write poetry, and she loved to write stories, and her brain just didn't work that way. And so she tried it a few times, and she says, oh, let's do this, and so she just dropped out. And so now she's married, and she has a child. But I think one of the things with homeschool is that we didn't follow curriculum. What we did was, what we wanted to keep the kids interested in was learning. And so we would let them pick a topic, and they'd write a little report, and at lunch, then they would give us their report. And so that, you know, there was a multitude of topics that way. And Then I got to the point where, you know, the kids, you know, they turn into teenagers, which is a subhuman species. And they didn't want to do it. You know, this is a mess to this. And so I call it 5 minutes school, 5 minutes here, 5 minutes there. But at the same time, Jim and I were very involved in psychology, and we were doing types, and so they were getting this whole thing by osmosis, you know, oh, mom, types again. You know, we'd meet somebody and say, well, what type is that person? And we'd do body types, too, and they'd say, well, that guy is really mesomorphic, or wow, he's really endomorphic. And so they were learning kind of a whole vocabulary, and I noticed that now this is, they just automatically talk about people that way, and they learned human differences really early, when we didn't know about it at all, you know, so we had to learn the hard way. Okay, now, the point of this is not how to go and live in the woods, because actually, we have people come and we're like a living museum, I think. They come and they wonder why we're doing this. And I think some people have the idea that the reason we're doing it is because we want to live back in the 17th century or the 18th century or some other, you know, era. But that isn't the reason. The reason, like I said before, is because we made a deal with fate. He says, okay, we want the time, and in order to have the time, we will agree not to spend a lot of money and to live as simply as possible, and therefore we'll get the time we need. So we have the solar panels. I started the video business in 1989. We had not had TV up until that point. When we were expecting Elizabeth, that was in 72. We hadn't had TV until then. I do have one story, though. The kids, being teenagers and their friends, you know, were seeing all these videos, and they wanted to see them, and couldn't we get all this stuff? Well, we weren't ready to get into this deal. So we went to a nearby town, we rented a motel room, a VCR, and 14 videos. And so in the space of 32 hours, they saw them all. So we didn't hear about videos, Because the point isn't to keep them away from that. It's just, you know, it's just the circumstances were such that, you know, we couldn't do that.
In the 18 years that you've lived there, neither one of you held down a job? Outside of, you know, the home?
Liz was born, Jim got the job. Just before John was born, Jim quit. We went up to the Sierra Mountains and we went to think about things. While he had been working, we had belonged to an art co-op in San Diego making candles. But there was one person in that co-op who was actually making money, and he was making these mirrored planter boxes. So we went back to San Diego and we said, look, teach us how to do it so that we can do it. He said, yes, under one condition, that you not do it on the West Coast. We said, fine, because, you know, we had family back east. And so we spent a couple of weeks, taught us how to do it, including taking these 4 feet by 8 feet sheets of mirror and cutting them up so that they could go behind the scroll of wood. And so off we went. And so we did that, I think, for a total of 8 years. We were still doing it. We did it, I think, 2 or 3 years, 3 or 4 years, yeah, we were still in the forest. And then, actually, we had one of my relatives died, so we got a little bit of money. And with that money, we decided to go ahead and start our book business. And we wrote books. I helped Jim with some of the books, but I got to the point where my mind doesn't really work that way. It's not an easy thing for me to do, and it is for him. And he had another about 20,000 more that he wanted to write. So I had the problem of what to do with myself. Even though the kids were there and there was school and we were doing everything, I still needed something for myself. And I agonized for 2 years about what to do. And I'd always had an attraction for photography, but the thought of getting a camera and shooting, and then you had to go ahead and develop it, and it costs a lot of money for the film and the developing, and then half of them are horrible, and, you know. When I just started reading video books, and I got really entranced by it. So I finally got to the point where I said I was interested in doing it. At that point, we were back east on a visit, and we knew a photographer would also go gone into video work, so he knew a really good camera for me if I wanted to do it. But Jim said, now look, if this is what you want to do, it cost me 9 cents a pencil. That's all I need to write my books. But if you go into the video business, this is going to be thousands of dollars. You know? So if you decide to do it, this is your decision. I wash my hands. I don't want to have anything to do with it. And so with that kind of encouragement and my back against the wall, I said, yes, I know I'm taking a chance and I may fall flat on my face and put us in some kind of economic hole, but yes, I want to do it. That was in October of 89. In 4 months later, we were back in Baja California at the bottom of a canyon with four teenagers, ours and two others, with a guide and mules. You go down this canyon. It takes about 3 hours. You know, when you're at the top, you see these tiny little palm trees. They have painted caves. Nobody knows who has done them. They're about 8,000 years old. And I wanted to film them. And so to do that, I needed a car battery and my monitor. And not this camera. I had one that was twice as big. And so I took everything down there. We had our tents. We had to bring every scrap of food. There was nothing down there. And so I filmed it. So that was kind of my training ground. I think 2 months after that, the four of us were in Europe because I wanted to do a video on the life of Jacques Maritain, a French philosopher. So then we were in Paris in our tents. So we had two tents, two for the kids and two for us. And John gets up in the middle of the night. When he comes back, somebody had slit the back of the tent, reached in, Liz was asleep, pulled out a jacket and some shirts because they wanted to go through the pockets to find money and stuff. And so the kids wake us up, and Jim, in our tent, we have all the camera gear. So he takes a rope and he threads it through all the handles, ties it around his wrist, and goes to sleep. So, anyway, that's how it went.
Didn't get it stolen.
Now, at this point, I've done over 30 videos. Every time we thought about doing a well, because nobody in the woods had a well, and so it was like going to Las Vegas, we decided that we would have a book printed. We started our own little publishing business, and so I tell Jim that we have 12 wells, because that's how many books we have. Okay, are there any more questions? Comments, yes.
Have you found that lifestyle fulfilling the way you felt or thought it was going to be in the first place? Or do you find after you practice that it's just like any other adjusting to any other role in life?
It's very different. I found that, for instance, when we would go to town, and I would go shopping, and here I am back in civilization with the lights and the water and stuff. I found myself kind of drained by that, and when we would go back to the forest, even the kids would feel this. It's like we got revitalized just by being in the woods. Certainly it wasn't like we thought, and there were a lot of problems that I never even dreamed we would have to face. However, what we weren't facing were people problems. You know, we didn't have problems with neighbors, at least two-legged ones. We have four-legged ones, but, you know. And it's just really different. Now, when I started the video business, I'm very introverted. And so, you know, if you were to hear that I was introverted to get a video and stick my camera in everybody's face is a really extroverted activity, you know, like standing up here and talking to you guys. But what happens is when I'm doing an interview and we sit down and we focus in on somebody and they're telling their story, and then I go home and I take that tape and I edit it down, it's sort of like magic, because the kind of people we're meeting have a special story. They're not, most of them are not known, but for one way or another we've found out about them and they have something really special to contribute. And so to come home and to be able to do that is like, it's like a special gift. Also, it's like some of those nature shots. When I zoom in on the tip of a pine branch, and there's a drop of water dangling off the end, sparkling like a diamond, it puts things in a kind of luminosity for me that you just don't go by it and ignore it. You begin to focus in on it. I also found that sometimes I would just go outside and sit there and watch the ants. You know, when you're a little kid, you watch the ants and it's kind of fun. But I find myself doing that or seeing what the squirrels are doing, and I just do nothing. I do nothing. I let myself just plain do nothing, even though there's plenty of stuff to do around the house and stuff. It's a real treat to do that. Now, that kind of thing I've learned to do in the forest, but that kind of thing you guys can do anywhere. There was a retreat we gave, and we were talking about this, and we said, now look, for an exercise, I want everybody to go outside and find one flower or one blade of grass or one little bird and just be there with it and try to get a sense of its isness, that it is. And so that's one of the gifts of taking up the expensive video business. Jim grew up in this in New York City, and I grew up in this in the suburbs in Connecticut, and so we had zero experience with this kind of life. And so what it forced us to do was to do things that we knew nothing about. And so, you know, we were trying to read a book and how to build a house, or, you know, what's a wood stove and how does it work, and baffles and flues and, you know, all that stuff was all Greek to us. And so I found myself having to do things that were not connatural to me. They were difficult for me to do. But I ended up, the percentages were more I succeeded than failed, and so it encouraged me to keep on going. And I think that is kind of one of the things I'd like to encourage you guys to do, to just go ahead and try stuff. If you're sick, you go to the doctor. If you want to learn something, you go to the teacher. I was talking to Father Tom, and we were fooling around with the harmonica thing, and I said, now look, Father, don't go to a harmonica teacher. And he went, you got me. You knew just exactly what I had in mind, because you figure if you really want to do something, you need a teacher, you have to get a professional, and then you have to do it right, and you have to do the little exercises or whatever. Why? Why? You know, if you do it wrong, fine, do it again. It's like a kid learning how to walk, falls flat on his face, gets up and tries again, finally gets the hang of it. You know, or you try something and you find that it's really not the thing for you to do, so you drop it and you pick something else up. I know that there are people who have different approaches to things, but this is the kind of approach that we've had, and it's really worked for us. After last session, I was talking with a couple of people, and they were talking about what happens when you have time. Now, when you see the video, you think that we went to the woods and we did all this work and we're busy doing all this work, and we're just having a grand old time because we have all kinds of things to do. But really the problem is that if you were to buy a piece of land and build your house, and you had all your systems going, you had everything down pat. For instance, only takes us about a half an hour a day to either bake the bread today or do the tofu. It's no big deal, something like half an hour. What do you do once you're set up? Or what do you do once you have the kind of lifestyle, the environment that you're satisfied with, and you have all this extra time? Let me tell you, we've been there 18 years, and to wake up every single morning and say, how am I going to spend this day? I have no boss to tell me. Not even Jim is going to tell me how I should spend my day. I have to make that decision day by day, hour by hour, and sometimes minute by minute in order to fill up my day. This is a challenge I can't even begin to tell you about, because we've had people come to visit us and they say, oh great, a week in the woods, I'm not going to do anything, I'm just going to sit there. 2 days later, they're in the car and they're going to town. The third day, oh well, you know, I forgot something. I'm out of cigarettes, you know, and off they go. They're back to town because they simply can't stand not knowing what to do. When I talked about not having the TV and those first 2 weeks were a real shock to the system about knowing what to do, that's what I'm talking about, only you magnify it over months and years. It's the kind of thing where you take supreme responsibility for your every single day. Do you get my drift? Mm-hmm. Okay, now another thing that I want to talk about is, and I'll just mention this because Jim's going to be taking over, is that in the kind of lifestyle we have, I know it's super radical, but it's about taking control. I'm going to read you one sentence that Mary Ruth, Sister Mary Luke, gave us the other day. It was in a different context, but I just want you to listen to the sentence. If I am living in such a way that it is really more for somebody else's interests than for my own good, I am living an alienated life. So if we're living the kind of life where our work day, our 40 hours a day, 40 hours a week are spent doing something that we're really not getting a lot out of, if we're doing it because somebody else is making millions of dollars and we're the secretary or whatever, how can we begin to get our life back? I think that's what it comes down to. What little things can we do to try to get our life back? And I'm going to turn it over to Jim, and he might have an idea or two.
I sort of want to talk about something related to this, but a little different. But there's no, no pressure that I have to get all this said. And so if you have any comments or questions during the time or tangents you want to go on, just raise your hand and do them, okay? You have that line of the poet that says, no man is an island. Mm-hmm. And even being out in what my kids used to call in moments of annoyance, the middle of nowhere, they're isolated out there. We're still part of the greater society. And we have to, we have to figure out how to pay the car insurance and the health insurance and buy food and do all these things. So it really is not an exercise in isolation or splendid Garden of Eden and let the world go its own way and suffer. It really isn't that. Like I said, it's sort of the outcome of a rash experiment that we got carried away with. It had some interesting consequences. They even had some physical consequences. For example, after we'd been out there a while, we went to town. And we went to see, we'd go to see my relatives in New York. And in fact, one time, we decided we would stay in the forest for a big chunk of the winter. That meant we could move around a little in the forest, but the rule was we really wouldn't get out and our feet wouldn't hit the pavement. So 80 days passed like this. We had all the food there, and we're thinking, well, is this going to be, you hear these stories about cabin fever, people going nuts. It wasn't like that at all. We had a lot of fun. The kids were running around. We're outside doing things. But anyway, after we did those 80 days, we took the Greyhound bus for 3 days and three nights and ended up on the New York subway because we were going to visit my folks. So we went back and forth from the forest to what is normal life, the way we grew up and the way most of us live. And then as we did that, we began to notice certain things. One of the things I noticed was about the dog. I'd grown up and I never realized how dark dark is until I'm in my house and it's nighttime, and sometimes I have shutters on some of the windows. But in any event, I put my hand up and I cannot see my hand. Something that I was not used to, because there was always some residual light in town sneaking through the blinds or the street light or something, but I couldn't see my hand. And I got to the point where I rather liked that. And another thing was noise. There was some noise in the forest because you'd hear the wind going through the pine trees and you hear the frogs and this kind of thing. We would go to town after we'd been out in the forest a while, and we'd stay with some friend, and the noise in their house was deafening to us, because the blower on the furnace would kick on. Things that we tune out because we're there all the time. It's sort of like this kind of thing, you know, where you have the blower going on and off and everything, and the refrigerator going on. Can you imagine someone being kept up by the refrigerator going on and off? Well, it's possible. You know, so we would go to town and say, my God, this noise here. So those were like physical changes. Did you ever dream about going off to another culture, like some Amazonian tribe? You're going to go and you're going to learn about their culture, and you're going to see it with your foreign eyes and see how they see things. Well, it was as if we became aliens to our own culture, because it was a strange experience, because we knew it intimately, because it's us, modern America, suburbia, whatever you want to call it, that was us. And then all of a sudden we had gotten so far out there that when we came back we were seeing it with a certain objectivity that we didn't have before. At least I hope it was objectivity, maybe just something else. And that's what I want to talk about. And I don't want it to sound like it's a negative thing, just a negative thing. But I want to talk about the kind of structures that become built in to our society, and they're so pervasive around us, we don't really realize they're there, and we take them for granted. And once we look at them, then maybe we could question them and say, is this really the way we want to go? A number of years ago, you heard all these reports about psychologists and sociologists were going to study how modern man was going to deal with his abundant leisure. Okay? And you saw this in all the magazines. You know, it was the big craze, because the big leisure boom is coming, and we're going to have to figure out how we're going to keep everybody busy, and we're going to build all these resorts and whatever we're going to do. Well, somewhere along the line, the leisure boom never appeared. What happened to it? Who knows? Where'd it go? How come we don't hear about that anymore? Somewhere it disappeared, and what you hear about, especially in the young families, are the two jobs and who's going to take care of the kids, and how with the two jobs we're just about getting it together economically. And you're into this thing that somehow we managed to go from the leisure boom that was about to fall on us to nobody has any time. Okay? We did a marriage retreat once, and we taped it, and there was a couple that hadn't been able to go to the retreat, and they wanted to see it. So we lent them the tape, and, you know, 3-4 weeks go by, and we say, gee, I wonder where that tape went. 6 weeks go by, finally about 7 or 8 weeks, the lady gives us back the tape, and she says, you know what the greatest thing we learned from this tape was? How long it took us, for the two of us, to have the time to sit down and look at this tape. Okay? That's what I mean by a structure that we've built into our society, And we now have the younger families who are seeing that as the way everybody lives. Okay? But it really wasn't. Even in our own lifetime, that was not how everybody lived. We had another rhythm, and we had many, many single wage earners in the family, and we just had another structure. I'm not trying to say that one is necessarily better than the other. We could have opinions about that. I'm trying to say that it has changed, and we should realize the change and wonder whether we want it that way. I think another issue along the same line is the question of housing. Okay? One of the big dreams of a lot of us, and now the young families, we're going to have a nice house, finally. We're working really hard to get it, and it does take a great deal of time and energy and money to do that. And many families have sacrificed and have gotten fairly nice house. Well, I was talking to some friends of ours who live in over near Cottage Grove in Oregon, and they work in the field of alternative housing. And one of the guys was an architect. And so he knew the whole scene about the building trades and architecture and all these things. And he said, do you realize that since World War II, or a little after, the size of the American home has doubled? The amount of people in it has been cut in half. Okay? What does that mean? Well, the math is clear. You know, you have maybe 25%, and even if it was just 50% of the people in the same amount of space. Okay? You put that together with the fact that you have both people out there earning the money to pay for this house, then you have a lot of housing square footage that nobody's in for a large portion of the day. Now, his response to this fact, so we have the raw facts of we've built this structure. It's nothing that existed all the time. We made it this way. The society made it this way, and it just sort of crept up on us, and then we find ourselves living like that. Let me use another example, because of a lot of us here are from religious life and so forth. Well, I don't think it's a lot. It's not that different, because somewhere, somehow, somebody is creating the material structures which we then have to live in and maintain. In religious life, certainly, I met a friend in Chicago, and I said, gee, you're thinner than I remember you being. And he said, I was living with the religious community, and now I'm living in my own apartment, and I don't get fed nearly as well. That was his point. And this is particularly true of the men's orders. The women always had it a bit tougher. But the men's orders, you never could eat as well as you could in a men's religious order. Usually it was the nuns in the kitchen cooking it too, but that's another story. But what I'm saying, we created a structure like that. And then we have and still have all these buildings and all these mortgages and all this need for money. I'm not saying this is bad. I'm saying it's crept up on us, and now we have it. And do we want it? It's fair to ask, do we want these things that are coming along as the unexamined baggage of our society? This is the other half, the societal half of the question about simplifying our lives. Part of the reason that it's very difficult to simplify our lives is because if we were to really simplify our lives, the next step in interacting with it is the simplification of society. I don't mean so much, you know, not that, go out and live in the woods and, you know, live life primitive or whatever that is. I don't mean that. I mean that if we have twice as much rooms, it's going to cost us twice as much to pay for it and twice as much to maintain it. And is that how we want to spend our energy? Okay? It's a fair question to ask, and everybody's going to ask it their own way, but it's fair to ask it. That's all I'm saying. Do we want to do what we're doing? When it comes to the church, do we want our energy to go into maintaining some institutional structure? Okay? It's fair to, for people who are giving their lives to the church to have a say in how it's spent. Okay? And if you feel your life is going too much in one direction and you prefer another, I don't see anything wrong with that. The same with the kind of lives we're leading out in the world. We don't choose them either a lot of times. We just accept what we get and then try to deal with it. And we're left with jobs and that. If you love your job, you're lucky. Lots of people don't. I know I didn't, and some of the ones I have. And I'm left looking, finally it dawns on me, whoever's running this operation has their agenda, and it doesn't necessarily coincide with mine. Maybe they want to be a millionaire, maybe they want to be powerful, whatever it is, it doesn't necessarily coincide with what I want to do, but they want me in a certain place at a certain time doing certain things for reasons that may be entirely inordinate from a Christian point of view. This brings us to the question of ordinateness. The simple life, or whatever you're going to call it, doesn't float in a vacuum. It's a question of what values anchor our choices. Okay? If we say we embrace holy poverty, what does that mean? If you look at religious life, in actual fact, sometimes it doesn't mean much of anything. It means a certain personal naming of possessions that belong to us, but there's such an abundance that you can swim through that without even feeling the pinch. Okay. So what are the values that anchor what we do? And so we're getting into a whole perspective here. Let me get back to the story of our friends in alternative building. Now Cobb is nothing more than you take earth, you take some sand, the earth has to have a little clay in it, you mix in straw, you mix a little water, you dance on it even and mix it up. It's sort of like adobe almost. But you form it into these lumps. The old English word cob, like we have cobblestones, is the same root. It's like a lump of earth that sort of sticks together. You take it and you put it down, and you can build a wall out of it, just piling them up and pushing them together. So they got into this, and it wasn't just the building technique. That wasn't the primary thing in their mind. It was, here's a single mother. She is never going to be able to afford to have her own house. Okay? She has her kids that she's trying to get by. And so they would take people and young people and whoever, and in 1 week, they would teach them how to build a house. And in fact, there was one single mother who actually went ahead after that, and she built her own house out of this call. The walls were earth, the floor became earth, and then they would put some kind of roof structure, beams and stuff like that, and they had built, the people who were running this alternative building program had built a couple of buildings, and they were living in them. One cute little one, it wasn't big, partly to avoid some of the problems they were going to get in with the code and things like that. They built a little house. There were two people living in there. loft up above, and they salvaged a bunch of materials, and it cost them $500 to build that house. Okay, now let's say if they made it twice or three times the bid, so maybe it cost them $1,500. You ever try to price the price of a garage now? You want to build a garage? It would be, you know, it's mind-boggling what it would take if you had a contractor come and build a garage or remodel your kitchen or something like that. Okay.
Tell them how much it cost to build our house.
Yeah, well, the house you saw, our house, before the kids built on the front half of it, that cost us $3,500 buying the lumber from the lumberyard. But it was like maybe 12 or 14 by 36. And that's what it was at the beginning, first built. Now, I'm not saying, oh, well, you know, this is impractical. We have to go out and build our own houses. No, we're not going to do it. You know, some of us might. What I'm saying is that it makes us think, and that's what we have to do no matter what situation we are in. Does our lifestyle fit with our values? Okay? And sometimes as Christians, we become obtuse to that because we think that because everybody does it in our society, that we as Christians are allowed to just go along and do it as well. Because, you know, there's the parish priest. Well, he's probably living better than most of the people in the parish. Economically, sometimes that's true. If he doesn't get it that way, then why should we? All right? Let me give you another example. Let's take ecology, okay? Are Christians in the forefront of the ecological movement? There's some talk about, you know, sending materials to the parish and everything, but if they are, I'm not aware of it. I'm not aware of it that you go to some place where they're really into some kind of ecological action. You're going to see big groups of Christians who are there because they realize that there is a certain truth of their faith being about, you know, preserving the earth. I don't think we're there yet. And yet there is, if we are really part of this universe, and this is the great gift of God to us, it's being trashed. Okay? Even in this country, it's being trashed. And if the Christian people, of which there's tens of millions of them, would say one word, the people in Congress would just roll over and do whatever they want. But they're not saying that word. Back where we live, all right, there's this beautiful forest. But this forest is under siege, is actually being destroyed. And it got to the point where there was like 10% of the old growth trees left. This doesn't mean virgin timber from forever. This means trees that were of a certain size that they could be classified as old growth. And the U.S. Forest Service, who simply was acting more or less like an arm of the timber industry, had designs on cutting a bunch of this. So there was a whole bunch of legal action, and in many cases they were prevented from cutting this last 10% of the old growth. All right. The next act is really, you know, really a ecological crime, because what happens is Congress, under the guise of passing what they call the salvage rider, to cut dead and dying trees to make our forests more healthy, you know, seems like a very great idea. They slip in there that any sale that was held up because it was an ecological disaster, it was held up in the courts, now can no longer be held up in the courts, but can be cut. All right? So just in our forest, I think that totaled, this is the Wenema National Forest, 35 million board feet of timber was going to be cut, of green forest. Okay? So figure your 10% is being chopped down. Just recently, the U.S. Forest Service in that same area decided that here was a good opportunity to, here's a big stretch, I think it was like 6 square miles of forest, green forest, that had never been sold. They said, well, let's sell it. Let's put it up for sale. And if anybody objects, we'll say it's under the salvage rider, so you can't challenge it in court under these past guidelines. And that's what they're doing right this minute. 20 million board feet of timber in this green forest. And they're going to claim it's to make the forest more healthy. Okay? And we're going to cut it down. Okay? What is happening? There it's clear. There are certain timber interests that have always gotten their way in places like Oregon and the Pacific Northwest, where many of our national forests are. And they spend enough money on the politicians through this, you know, political action committees and whatever, to get this kind of legislation passed. They figure the rest of us, in the rest of the country, don't know and don't really care. They don't figure you're going to ever realize it's your national forest, so they're going to cut it down to get some more money, and then it'll be gone. I have a page on my table there that explains this. I don't know what your people from Kansas or Wisconsin, wherever you come from, how they voted, but I think they would be surprised if they ever got a letter from one of their constituents being concerned about the national forests of the Pacific Northwest being cut down. So anybody who's inclined that way, I have the particulars on the page back there. But that's just another example. We're individuals, and we say, well, what can we do? In this case, a couple of people in the local area, one lady who had grown up there on a big old ranch, and her father had been like a cattle rancher, and he became a kind of a naturalist. Actually wrote some books, maybe you've seen them, about, one was called Yamsey. He has a big ranch. The stuff was even in Reader's Digest kind of thing. Anyway, that woman, another woman we know, they saw a whole stretch of forest being cut down right near their house, and they said, can they do this? Can they just come in here and destroy it all? Happened to be private land. The answer was, yes. Go in there, destroy it as much as you want, run over anything that's left, and leave with your money. The laws of dealing with private timber holding, what you have to do, were practically non-existent. They're not much better now. Anyway, so they started this local group called the Concerned Friends of the Wenema being the Wenema National Forest. And they began to go around and look at these timber sales and talk to the Forest Service, and the Forest Service is sort of going, my God, somebody's even actually asked, you know, questioning our judgment. And so they actually did a lot of good, two ladies who took it in their mind that they were tired of this. They had no background in forestry or botany or anything. They just felt in their heart that this was wrong. So they went out there and tried to do something. All right, so what I'm saying is we're living in a world we didn't make. You know, we're not responsible in the specific sense that we're cutting down those trees. Or, you know, we're responsible for the fact that we now live in a nice home that we spent an awful lot of energy trying to get. I'm not trying to make it into some kind of guilt. All I'm trying to say is, can we open our eyes and see the kind of society we're making and see if it fits our values? One final aspect of this before I want you to make comments is the sense of community. There's beautiful ideas about community floating around. We've had them ourselves. We said, gee, wouldn't it be great? Here we are living out here, and we're by ourselves sometimes. And wouldn't it be great to create a community? We find some nice piece of land, four or five families. We each own one little piece of it. We have a common ground. We help each other build the houses. We bring in all this solar stuff. We create some kind of community center, or maybe a retreat thing, or some kind of ministry thing. Why can't we do that? And then we said, oh gee, it's too complicated. It's too hard to do. It's too many problems. So we have, you know, maybe we're not good at it, or whatever. But the idea is not just us, but other people are having those ideas, and there's no real reason that we can't restructure the way we live. It may be good. It would be nice if I had my neighbors that I really knew and liked right next to me, and we're helping each other out. And it'd be nice if you we could do some kind of work and create our own little center that people could come from the outside. Okay, so what we have is a certain kind of ability to ask ourselves, are we living the lives we want, and what are we being called to, what do our values demand of us? And it's as simple as that. It may be that we're doing what we can do, and we feel that way, and then we're at peace. But other times things come up, and they nag at us because we say, gee, I wish I could do something. This happens to us with the forest issue. It's not something we're good at, not something we want to devote lots of time to. But over and over again, there comes a time where we end up getting involved in some little part of it. We're writing letters, or we made a video about it and showed it in the local town. Because we're there, we owe it to the forest to do something. And sometimes we're in the community and we owe it to the community to do something. All right, I'm going to stop there, and if Dennis would tell us a few things about what he was telling me before, I think that's a good way to start.
Our son is an architect, starting out in architecture, and he has carried forth this real vision of environmentalism and the lack of community. I think you can see it, I guess you can see it, the problem in the sprawling of the suburbs, and also he was in Montana for a while, around Bozeman. I don't know if many of you have been in that area, but it's beautiful country, wide open country, and what happens out there, one person will buy 5 acres of land out on the side of a big mountain or hillside, fence it, and build their house, and it really spoils the whole environment. In the suburbs, I think you have a situation where you have a sprawling suburbs running over the land, using very fertile farmland that has gone to waste with either small or 5 acre lots, in a lot of cases 3 to 5 acre lots, and just rampaging over the land. So at least his thrust in trying to address this, is trying to get people together in what now I think is well known as cluster type housing, where you still can have that feeling of being out, or you have that being out in a natural surroundings, but you do it in a way that's environmentally sound. If there are people that want to be in that environment, instead of one buying 5 acres, the next one buying 5 acres, the next one
buy 5 acres and everybody lives separated, bring all the houses together, you all own open land, and then you have a community house or condominium type houses or individual houses, but clustered very closely, that would then also form the center of a community. So, and that actually, in Wisconsin, we are just across the St. Croix River from Minneapolis-St. Paul, which is about 1.5 million people. That is happening in western Wisconsin and in part of Minnesota along the river, where the townships have said, we just don't want to put up with this, just this rampage over the land, and they are zoning for that type of development, so that it will be more, hopefully, environmentally sound. The good fertile land will remain there for all of us, all of the future generations, to enjoy and to form this community. So I guess that was my thoughts on it.
Good, thanks, Dennis. How about some comments or questions about what we're talking about here?
Lots of us can't move to a new home like that. It sounds like really neat, but each one of us can do simple things like recycling. You know, the aluminum and the glass and the newspapers, and it's, you know, it's, if each one does that, it just really helps our environment.
And you're very right. In fact, one of the very well-known environmentalists, Avery Lovins, said that, you know, the critical first step for this country is to stop wasting it. Okay? In other words, there is so much energy, you could say, it's mind-boggling. For example, redesigning electric motors. Lots of electric motors are terribly inefficient. Redesigning buildings that have a tremendous air conditioning load. I don't know about this one, and when it was designed, and who did it, so I can't say that, but you have to know that the utility bills complex like this are enormous. And so if you cut the bill by, cut the energy use by 10% or whatever, and there are all these new techniques that are coming up how to do that and new materials. This is a tremendous thing. I don't know how many of you have seen the like Real Goods catalog, which is, they started off as an alternative solar type people selling all sorts of solar hardware. But they also have light bulbs that screw into your fixture that are fluorescent light bulbs that give you the same light with like 1/4 of the energy. Same things happen with shower heads, where you can use half the water, get the same shower. Toilets, that's a big one. I mean, they're having problems with some of these new high, you know, less water toilets, but it's sort of ridiculous to kind of take the amount of water we're using, put a little bit of waste in it, into 5 gallons of water, send it all through this giant system, and then try to take the little bit of waste out. It's a mind-boggling thing. And then in some parts of the country, we actually have water problems, but we're not even there as far as any kind of tough conservation, you know. You go to those parts of the country, the guy still wants his lawn. It's in Arizona or somewhere, he wants his lawn, and they don't want him to have it. Let him grow cactus or something, his swimming pool, whatever. We're into a society of such abundance that we're not doing that.
Jim, you were talking about all the structures in our culture that lock us in, and I agree, they're out there. But on the other hand, I think our nation offers some of the greatest freedoms for anybody that's willing to take them. In other words, if we can stand back and look at these things and see them, there is a lifestyle that can be led at a lower cost and without getting into this whole realm of things. There are low-cost houses. There are houses that are one half the size or one quarter the size of the big ones that you can purchase or that you can build. So I think it's all a matter of how you look at it too. In other words, instead of saying, let's change the whole thing, if we really want to change it, the place to start is at home. Is, I guess, we're not helpless to change it. We can live, for instance, on one income if we so desire in the United States. And we can live better than most of the other people in the world on one income if we want. So I think it's as much the fault of every one of us that is living a lifestyle that we don't want to live. Change it.
I basically agree. I think it's just, unfortunately, it builds up a certain momentum.
Sure.
And I don't know who I was talking to. It may have been Dennis, the other Dennis, who was teaching high school. Doesn't he teach high school? Mm-hmm. Anyway, he was talking about the kids, and it was in a Tonya part of town, and now his kids were going to go there, and their minds were already embedded in a certain value system where it wasn't like they thought of there being alternatives. They just thought about, this is how you keep score and this is how you show that you made it by having that big house or that fancy car or whatever. So we're up against that as well.
There's pressures.
Yeah.
Without question.